Hello everyone, I'm Shalini Davolkar, the COO of India SME Accelerator Network, and I take this opportunity to welcome all of you to an exclusive interview on celebrating entrepreneurship. As a business accelerator of MSMEs, our endeavors have always been towards providing micro-level support to small and medium businesses. And our flagship program, Accelerator Programs, that we run, help businesses with a professional engagement in a month, and our MSME Springboard handholds them beyond that in the longer journey of growth. Today, we celebrate the annual World MSME Day, marking the day to celebrate entrepreneurship. And what better than hearing it from an entrepreneur himself? It's important for small businesses to dream big and understand from successful entrepreneurs on how they have made it big. Data shows that almost 90% of MSMEs are micro in India. And there is a struggle to transition from micro to small and from small to medium. So we are here to understand how this should be done. The rich legacy of Chitle Bandhu traces back to 1939, when the visionary late Sri Bhaskar Ganesh Chitle started a humble milk distribution business in the Sangli district of Maharashtra. Then the second generation Chitle stalwarts went beyond milk to ensure steady growth of confectionery wing, and marked by the establishment of manufacturing and retail outlets for mithai and snacks as well. The third generation members of the family carried the mantle forth by introducing modern and innovative ideas to help the Chitle brand pace ahead of competition in the millennia. Today we have with us Mr. Indraneel Chitle, the fourth generation partner of the 81-year-old Chitle Group. He joined the family business full-time from the year 2011 and is pursuing his executive MBA at Harvard Business School, Boston. He has handled multiple roles in Chitle that include manufacturing, operations, supply chain, data management, and MIS. Indraneel now focuses on strategy and the operations domain, data management, and using artificial intelligence and machine learning to get the last mile visibility for the business. On that note, I wish a very, very warm welcome to Mr. Indraneel Chitle.
Thank you, Shalini. Thanks a lot. It's a pleasure to be here.
Great. So if you're okay, we can begin with some of the questions that our enterprises will be happy to hear from you, Mr. Chitle.
Sure, I'll be glad to. First of all, I would say the description just makes me sound too good. So, I'm normally just a regular entrepreneur just doing his work. So, thanks for the nice readout, I would say.
That's very humble of you, Mr. Chitle. So, firstly, I would like to ask you, as the Chitle Group that you are, could you tell us what are the current businesses that you're in and what is the scale of operations that we should understand of the Chitle Group?
So now Chitle Group primarily operates into two domains. One is our liquid milk and milk operations. That is primarily handled through our group company called Chitle Dairy. There are other product companies which are affiliated in the group, which are Chitle Sweets and Snacks, Chitle Agro, Chitle Foods, Chitle Ranze units, and all of these funnel into the organization, which is Chitle Bandhu, which is the retail arm of the business. So Chitle Bandhu basically takes care of the products, and Chitle Dairy takes care of the dairy business. And the products are now sold in three domains. So one is our store domain, where we operate 25 stores in the city of Pune itself, and about 27 and growing Chitle Express stores, which are spread across Maharashtra. All of these are franchised stores where the group companies take care of manufacturing and supplying the product, and the operations of the store are now owned and operated by the franchisee. The second area of operations would be the distribution chain market, where we are now present in close to 9 states, and our products are distributed in the distribution chain, which is where it is, be it the Kirana stores, be it the mom and pop stores, the local stores, right from as small as the pan taparis going up to as big as the supermarkets that we see. And the width of it is that, you know, we operate through about 500, 600 odd distributors, 70, 75 super stockers, two master warehouses. And we reach a little over 1.5 lakh stores on a weekly basis through this network.
Wow.
And the third aspect of sale would be the export business, where we are exporting to North America, South America, to Africa, Middle East, Europe, Scandinavia, to Southeast Asia and Australia and New Zealand. So we even exported once to Antarctica, where we have a research center for by the government of India. But so that way we've actually exported products to all seven continents.
Oh, excellent. Sounds very, very, very exciting actually. Antarctica is the place you have been.
I have not been. The product has been there.
Yes. I mean, the product has been excellent. Wonderful.
And while supporting all of this, we have a couple of group companies that basically take care of the backward integration and the current integration, where it's purely about the data management, the hardware, running of our SAP system, and you know, just collating all the data right from the farmer and animal cattle management, going up to what our retailers are buying and the pattern in which they are buying, and just getting all of that data sets generated to create actionable insights with the data. So that's all handled through a couple of group companies, and we also happen to have a joint venture which is managed by one of my uncles, which is into genetics. So since we are a dairy company, the animals and their genetics play a very important role, and we have a joint venture with a British company where we are doing about close to more than about 2 million doses of you know, animal, you know, IVF doses for animals that are further improving the quality of the cattle that's being born further.
Right, understand.
So that is the span of the business that Chitay Group now operates. And we end up generating direct employment for close to about 2,000 people and indirect employment through our channels and partners of about 4,500 people.
Wow. That was a great roundup to understand both forward integration that you've done as well as backward integration, and also, you know, getting into futuristic areas like genetics, you know, makes so much sense.
Thank you.
Wonderful. So my next question is to say, before becoming this large business that you are today, I'm sure you know, somewhere would have started small and been a micro business and then moved into a small business and then into a medium business, and then becoming a large corporate. So could you please tell us a little about this crucial journey that you would have made from where you started as a micro enterprise? Because many of our MSMEs here would be very, very delighted to understand, you know, positive to understand how to make that critical transition from a micro to a small and a medium business.
So I would say, you know, this transition has happened over 81 years for us. And spread over four generations, where what I would identify is that, you know, from starting as a dairy supplier to a couple of other brands in the city of Mumbai and then Pune, to becoming our own brand, then creating another brand, then creating different channels for business, and now evolving that further into just being one quarter of the sale of business and then creating new horizons for business. These are transitions that have happened over 80 years. And effectively, if I was to see, these were all made strategically at that time just to keep ourselves relevant. So appealing to the consumer's demand and, you know, doing those kind of transitions is something that strategically needs to be taken care of by the management. And effectively, every generation did that, which is where probably we got a great, you know, platform to build upon and increase that business further. But what I would, if I was to see why those transitions were necessary, it is that, you know, we did something different at every step and changed the way we were doing business and increased the number of revenue streams that were bringing business to us. Since that happened, that transition could effectively go in from being a supplier to other dairy businesses to becoming a brand of its own, to now being a conglomerate where we have multiple businesses inside the group umbrella.
That's a very crucial point you made with regards to, you know, being a vendor to becoming a brand of your own. And the second point also being relevant to, you know, what is required from the consumer perspective. Both these are key elements to pick up, especially when you want to grow to a completely different scale of business. And what is also interesting is the transition within the business from one generation down to another, you know, taking on the mantle to take it to the next level. I think that's also, you know, absolutely brilliantly done, something that people should pick up and learn from, you know, building.
Yeah, I think so. Nowadays, we see a lot about the governance aspect and the strategic aspect that we need to bring into the business. So somehow I would say I am lucky that, you know, the family since my grandfather's era were able to design that framework internally where we could just create new ideas and get those into good value-sized businesses. So that way, those frameworks and structures are very important for businesses to scale up.
So true. Brilliant. Mr. Chitli, my next question to you. In the initial years, you know, when you were a smaller business, I'm sure there would have been a lot of struggle, possibly, around finance and cash flows, and which is something that every small business, you know, goes through in the transition phase. So, what is your, you know, recommendation on how they should manage that initial phase?
I think the struggle is there, and there is this proverb that I have seen somewhere that maybe I might be wrong in structuring it, but turnover is more like a vanity. Profit is reality, and cash flows is sanity.
Okay.
So that way, everybody needs to look into not just the turnover of the business, but into how the finances and the profits and the way the money is coming in and going out.
Absolutely.
And I think I never had a chance to discuss this with my grandfather because when he was alive, I was too young to understand all of these aspects. I would say the reason that Chitaye Bandhu Mithai Wale as a brand came into picture was to manage the cash flows and the profitability for Chitaye Group. So we were there in the dairy business and it started on its own. But initially we were just acting as suppliers to other brands. So our payments used to be delayed by cycles there. Then eventually we started selling milk on our own, where milk was a great way to generate cash flows and it still is because it's consumed daily. So that's why people are paying for it daily and the inventory turnaround is much faster. But because of it being a commodity, the profitability in that business is relatively low. So it's a game of scale. So while doing that, how do we start generating profit is probably, and also what do we do about the excess milk which we had at that time, being a new brand, is where the Mithai business came into picture, that we started converting milk into products which were always enjoying better profit margins. And those margins are where, you know, we started making money and that got invested back into the business.
Got it. Absolutely.
So these two parallel streams of revenue generation were put into picture in the early years of the business itself, where one was great at making profit, the other was great at giving cash flows. And that way the daily requirements or the operational funds and the investment funds were being generated by the business itself. And the fact that all of this money was being reinvested into the business was just able to boost the ability of the business to grow. So the initial years were a struggle, I'm sure, because so my father and his cousins have lived in rented to one bedroom houses in their early years as well. And from there, you know, it changed where there was a certain affluence that finally came. So it's transitioned over, say, 30, 40 years of hard work. But that is what has made the foundation really good for us.
So true, because at the end of the day, it's the perseverance of, you know, making it happen that drives, you know, the entire transition. And brilliantly put, I think a lot of ideas to be picked up from here for MSMEs and what you just said. Two things that they need to understand. One is, how do you utilize existing inventory, as you said, the excess milk, and encash that with a new revenue stream? And how do you manage the mismatch of cash flow? Brilliant.
So I am seeing currently that, post the lockdown and especially, so I have a couple of friends who are into the automotive or the component business, auto component business, and they just end up generating a lot of scrap. But now with that scrap and just the right kind of tooling or, post-processing that goes onto it, that can be a value-added product that is helping them, bridge their cash flows and be a lot more productive or profitable in terms of the money that they generate out of that scrap. So that way, how can these value additions be done is something that the entrepreneur needs to keep thinking, so that you know you are constantly in that thriving mode as a business.
Perfect. I hope our entrepreneurs are taking their notes right now and making the best out of all these insights. One of the key elements that come with growth, as you would have experienced definitely, especially when you have begun the Mithai Wale outlets of yours and the brand building that you have done over the years. With that scale, a fast growing number of customers are built in, I'm sure. So how do you manage the customer connect and the delight of customers in this growing industry?
So previously it was just all about presence because and that time the family also spent a lot of time in the store just being in front of the consumer. So not that we actually did anything in the operations of the store as much as it was about being seen and being heard, which is something that's necessary for the consumer to having faith on the brand. So those visibility optics play a very important role, and as entrepreneurs we have to make time for it. Fortunately, now post the dot-com boom and the whole social networking era that we are in right now, building brands and having that consumer connect is super easy compared to what used to be the case where you had to spend those hours. So how do we use the power of social media, just the communication mediums, use those as exchange platforms to interact with your consumers? How do you attend to consumer concerns or queries or complaints? And all of this just helps build the brand value or that faith of the consumer inside your brand. So that way, these are the efforts that organizations will have to put in, or rather it's inevitable now. So no matter the size of the business, if you are not present on the mediums where your consumers are present, then you are going to lose out on that, the faith or the loyalty aspect that the consumer brings to you as a brand.
Very true. And it's a fiercely competitive market. So keeping yourself out there and known and standing out is quite a thing. So in this journey, I'm sure there is a lot that had to be done to manage the scale, and one of the key levers for that would have been IT. And we also know that you are taking care of data management, AI, ML in your business. So how are you using and leveraging IT to transform your business?
Yeah, so I, there was a time when the window, the brand window and the finances were just the two pillars that we would say were critical to be maintained. The third would be quality, of course. But along with that, now I feel that it's not a tripod, it's like a four-legged stool where IT now is the fourth cog in this foundation. It's no more an added expense. It should be part of your bone structure or foundation itself. So we have now, thanks to the efforts that started from my generation before me, since the usage of RFID cards in our stores, if you've probably been there, we've just been generating a lot of data at a lot of fronts. So we have close to about 5,000 input-output points inside our factory, or more so in our distributors and superstockists and stores as well. So all of this data needs to be funneled into an architecture where you are able to make sense out of that data and see that how you as owners, managers, and your team of professionals are able to use that to make very well-informed decisions. So that's why we have a IT infrastructure which starts right from our collection mechanism of milk, where we have a lot of farmers who are on our cloud network with the animal tracking, going up to the point where be it any retailer in any state now, so be it suppose in Chennai, there is a store called ABC Stores. We know what ABC Stores is buying, how frequently they are buying, what patterns they are buying, what products they are buying. So that backward integration helps us determine what manufacturing we need to do when our sales guys are going onto that route of ABC Stores. So as long as this chain from your consumer to your procurement, everything is streamlined into one IT funnel, your productivity just improves a lot. And while doing that, your wastages go down and you are able to reach your consumer in a much more effective manner. So that's why it's like blood now. Yeah, it's inevitable. It's, you have to survive, then you have to have IT in your system now.
Absolutely. So true. And I really hope entrepreneurs out there are realizing how important it is to apply these concepts of IT effectively into the business. So if you heard 5,000 touch points that he mentioned, I mean, that's a great value. One is picking up the data, and the other way, how beautifully it is used end of the day to understand what, you know, you need to do with that data.
Because I see that as a big problem, that, you know, now we have most MSMEs using some sort of ERP, which is probably in their process end. But it becomes a silo where that ERP does not get out of the factory or the manufacturing environment. So there is no backward linkage to what your suppliers are doing, what your vendors are doing, and also no forward linkage as to how that is impacting your sale. So when all of this silos start coming together and form a pyramid, that is when the effectivity of having this data generation plays an important role.
Totally agree. So this is a big transition for a business to go through, and like you beautifully put, you know, you've been through three generations as a business, and now as a fourth generation that you're handling what is relevant today in today's context, and you're building the future as well. So for this kind of a planning to be done, you know, how has the AAA group looked at the enterprise planning, especially the leadership planning and succession within the family business? That becomes a crucial element when it comes to family-run businesses.
So I would say we are still in that evolution phase. It's not something that has stopped, and it will keep evolving. But credit goes entirely to the generations before me, where be it my grandfather's generation, where him and his brothers were able to determine what roles everybody plays, so that there was a clarity as to who does what. Because my great-grandmother was an instrumental factor in determining all of this, that she understood that if her sons are going to be in business together, they first need to start living separately. And every son and their wife need to have their own space, so that they can actually collaborate rather than keep sharing and fighting about it. So that is where I think the succession planning started. Probably it was not a hashtagged word that time, but that is where she created that space. And I think that went further into the next generation, where the grandfathers understood that, you know, this made the things functional. So their next generation were already, whenever they joined the businesses, they had a role that was well defined for them. So while, of course, they were able to be cross-functional and handle multiple avenues inside the business, because it was a growing business, they were pretty clear that somebody does not do this and somebody will do this. So when that clarity existed, that handover from the third generation to fourth generation became easy for us. So as per the statistics, it's only 2% businesses that go into the fourth generation from the third. So they did something right, which is why we get to inherit what we get. At this moment. So whenever me or my cousins in my generation joined a business, we were pretty sure about what to expect when we joined after getting our degrees and working outside for some time. So that clarity just ensured that we were all always that there in a complementary angles to each other, where one was adding this loop, the other one was adding this loop. So we were closing the circle together. So that is how that foundation was built, and since that clarity is there, we have bandwidth to accommodate more people inside.
Wow, it almost
and sounds- now with that bandwidth, especially now in the fourth generation, if when we are looking at succession planning for the fifth generation, who we don't know whether they want to join the business or not, whether it is cool for them or not, whenever the time comes, we have to have more professionals running the business as well. But in family businesses, the problem is that very often the professionals don't understand who the boss is, because there are four people seeing the same thing in different manners. So if you want to get good professionals, your bosses or the partners or the owners need to be very clear about how communication goes, how the mandate is, how the decision making happens, and who does what. So now with this structure in place, we've actually had a mechanism where now we have good professionals working for us as well. And that proved its importance last year during COVID, when all of us in Pune were down with COVID, the family. And it was the professionals running the show just, say, 2 weeks before Ganpati. So had we not had professional management and people who were running the show, that would have been a nightmare for a family business.
Oh, that sounds really, so thought through as a business, to be able to do, manage it well with professionals. And that's a very important challenge you address, truly.
So we have to start creating those avenues and boundaries and also basically just the frameworks on where to accommodate whom and what should they be expecting. When that is clear, I think it doesn't matter whether it's a family business or it's a corporate or, you know, it's a multinational. Clarity of role and vision as to where the organization is, where it wants to go and what your role in doing that is. Just make sure that everybody is productive and aligned to the goal.
Perfect. You just touched upon an important aspect of COVID and how as a business you were impacted and how the professionals would manage that. In the recent COVID, a lot of issues came up with regards to human resources in particular, as people suffered both personally as well as professionally within businesses. So what is your advice to keep human resources motivated in these tough times of COVID, slowdown, and, you know, this current wave one, now we are in wave two, and we are, you know, possibly heading towards a wave three. So how do you think they, you know, keep people motivated in the business?
So I think this has to be a top-down approach. The management sets the cue as to how the entire team is motivated. So it depends on the leaders entirely that, you know, they are very positive and optimistic about what to expect in the future. So yes, I think there has been no business in the country right now, apart from say the pharma business, who have not had to bear the brunt of COVID. And I would say still that the pharma, apart from the vaccine suppliers, are also suffering because all other planned surgeries or medications and everything has been taken a backseat as well. So that way, uncertainty is going to be there. There is no exception to that. But we have to, as business, first be agile about it. Second, we have to get out of the denial mode that, you know, this is not just happening to me, it's happening to everybody. And what do we do or make amends so that we still remain relevant as the world evolves. So this post-COVID world that we are looking at, you know, the consumer patterns are going to be different. The avenues of buying products are going to be different. The appeal of products itself is going to be different because priorities have changed. So suddenly from indulgence, everybody is talking about health. So where do we as organizations get the entire offering as a brand? Position towards creating value is something that we have to work upon. And when all of this is communicated to the the lowest chunk in the pyramid of the organization, motivation is usually okay. And it's human to be having an off day. So we have to accept that. It's human to be having an off month as well, especially in a situation like this where probably just not socializing, just not meeting people, and it's just been work, a lot of strict protocols, and then going home. So having that open channel for communication, talking a lot, and just ensuring that all concerns are heard and addressed itself helps the organization remain glued together and aligned towards what we want to achieve. So, and I would say this is still a work in progress. We have to keep doing a lot more and we'll keep learning as we progress. So no fixed answer apart from having open communication dialogues to this.
Wonderful. So how do you maintain a communication channel?
So lately, social media has been super useful. So be it the internal WhatsApp groups or just, you know, having those video messages or having written notes sent to people or, you know, having those open dialogues on Zoom, just like we are having right now, where different departments or teams and different cities and towns, you know, we just get to talk, not business also at times. The fact that they are being heard is a great, great empowering tool for most people who are employed in your organization. So as leaders, it's our job to listen to what the concerns are.
So true, so true. I think wonderful ways to maintain the connect with people. You know, the heart-to-heart connect has to be there for employees to believe that they still are contributing in a major way to the organization and they are a part of something larger. Great.
Correct.
So a lot of enterprises have been affected by COVID, wave one and wave two, and, you know, whatever is coming ahead. So in terms of growing out of this challenge, growing out of this space, you know, whatever dent it can add to the businesses, how do you recommend we go about reviving and building from them?
So I would say one thing we have to understand is that how has the market evolved for the product or the service that any business is offering. Is it that the service is in demand, but COVID could not allow you to service it, or the product is in demand, but you just did not have an avenue to sell it? Or is it that, you know, the whole concept of your product or service has changed, where what was great pre-COVID is just not great anymore post-COVID? So if we are able to just break it down into these two aspects, where there is a need, but the avenue has changed, or there is just no need and we have to change the product or offering, whatever we have. So if this is something that entrepreneurs can keep analyzing and keep thinking about, I'm sure getting there will be a understanding of what not to do. So very often in businesses, the thing is that, you know, for all the data and for all the tools that we as entrepreneurs get, the difference between entrepreneurs and managers is that managers take decisions based on complete availability of data. And they are, you know, aligned with what the organization thinks. But leaders have to steer the organization into an unknown direction where these are some reference points, but then it is a gut call. So how do we keep studying all of this as entrepreneurs? And firstly, for all of this, do we as entrepreneurs or leaders have the mental bandwidth to think about this? Is something that we have to keep thinking upon. Because if we are not thinking and just being operational entrepreneurs, then we are as good as our managers.
Right.
So whenever all of these thought processes start coming in, we at least know that this is something that is absolutely not to be done. Let us think about doing this as option A or B or C. Maybe A is not right, but right now it feels okay. But we know that option D is a no-go. We don't go there. So then you start taking positions and then you start building upon it. So the uncertainty is there. I'm sure it's not going away for a year or more at least. But then what positions do we as entrepreneurs take is something that we have to start putting in our effort upon so that we can bounce out of this COVID recovery on a stable note. Because unlike last year's wave, which was more like a pent-up V-shaped recovery, where everybody just, you know, everything went down and everything went upstate. This year, the middle class and you know, affluent have been more affected by COVID. So that has hurt the spending sentiments everywhere. So we need to understand that now this impact has just made everybody a lot more conscious compared to what was the case last year. So that's why we have to keep evolving. So I'm in that same zone right now where I'm thinking all the time that, you know, how do we just, you know, evolve and be more relevant in the time to come. And I'm sure if entrepreneurs keep doing that, they will find an answer. And probably use help from guys like you who are just helping entrepreneurs.
So true. We're always there to help in multiple ways. So true. But this challenging phase has put everyone to think, you know, finally sit back and think. I think people have been running at a pace for so many years, and this has given them some time to sit down and relook at the drawing board of where they are. But we also have to recognize that this is not a one-time thing. Business is in a dynamic risk environment all the time. And the exposure to multiple risks and situations like this could come from not just a pandemic, but an economic policy, an environment, a slowdown, you know, global factors impacting the business industry that each one is in, and so on. So what is your suggestion for businesses to, you know, ensure a strong resilience within the business to be able to withstand these kind of, you know, factors?
You know, so one is, of course, playing to your strength. So what is your organization or a brand strength is something that you have to work upon. So for example, in our case, our brand is known for our quality. So whenever things were a little sketchy and people were afraid, they preferred spending a little more, but they'll buy quality products. So we actually saw an upward trend in our business. So we played to our strengths. We started showcasing more about what quality measures we are doing, what automation we put in picture, how robots are helping make things faster, etc., etc. So we were communicating to our consumers what we thought they would be looking at hearing. And when that, you know, linkage of what was demand and what was being supplied could marry, we could just solve the problem there. So that way we played to our strength. Similarly, you know, I think the England test match is starting right now. So if I was to give a reference to test cricket, the thing is that, you know, if you're playing in England or New Zealand, the ball is going to swing. Right now it's those swinging conditions. So you just play defensively. Don't try to go out for a six on the first ball of the over. You know, just get set in, be there, spend 200, 300 balls, whatever you want on the crease. then I think the form will come naturally. So it's right now just about being there, out there, and waiting patiently.
It's a wonderful example, you know, well put. I'm sure businesses have a lot to take from here in terms of what Mr. Rathnani has been sharing with us. And I hope you've had the chance to take down your notes as well in terms of, you know, what you could do, you know, the business applications that you picked up from all that he has said so far. Please benefit from that and see what you can apply back in your business in whichever industry or service that you might be in, whichever job. On that note, I'm really glad that you had something to take back today from Mr. Indraneel Chitle. Mr. Chitle, before we kind of conclude the questions, I wanted to ask you a couple of more questions.
Sure.
Patch into the video as well. So one of the questions is, you know, it's an entrepreneur's life is extremely, I would say, a very, very dynamic, a tough one where you're always on your toes, you're always running, you're always thinking, what should I be doing today and what should I be doing next? So given that, it consumes an individual quite a lot compared to somebody in a corporate job sitting probably with the good stability, etc. So given the environment that an entrepreneur works in, how should one balance work life, especially when it consumes so much of you into your business? So how are you doing that, and how do you recommend people take care of, you know, pursuing their own passion and, you know, various other things alongside, you know, being available for business almost all the time?
See, I think the demand for your availability at business is never going to stop. What role are you going to do in that is something that you have to keep determining. So over the last 2-3 years, I have focused heavily on delegating the operational task to professionals, and I put in more effort to manage my bandwidth on a strategic side. So this was a conscious, deliberate effort where the cost of hiring professionals was extremely difficult for me to sell to the board, because they were telling me that, you know, we are paying you that money for you to be available. So what's the problem with this? So, you know, delegation is not easy, especially when we are not system oriented nation. We are not system oriented. So naturally, Indians, we do not like delegating. We like doing everything on our own. But not everything can be done on our own, because that is, once you start having good teams around you, you can start having the liberty of utilizing your time the way you want. Obviously, that does not mean you're just going around doing nothing. You have to keep doing, but then how do you keep adding value is something that keeps evolving to the organization as well. But while doing that, I think we have to spend that much time or schedule ourselves in a manner where we have time for our passions or pursuits. So I enjoy playing a lot of musical instruments, and I make sure that I make that much time out. What 1 hour in a week is not going to be a difficult thing to spare, or, you know, working out is mandatory now, because that's just taking care of your health. So it's like, you know, scheduled maintenance for your body. So how do you prioritize all of those and get into your schedule is something that we have to keep thinking about, pondering about, and keep evolving as we go. Along with that, of course, it's the family life and giving time to your family and kids, everyone around. So if I was to summarize it, it would be, it's something like, you know, it's like being in a marriage. So, you know, you can get married and get those garlands into each other's heads, but that does not mean it's going to be a happily married life all along. If it's going to be a happy, good married life, then you have to put in the effort each and every day on both sides. And when those efforts are there and, you know, those actions are taken and that intent is there, things start falling into place. So there will be bad days, there will be good days, there will be excellent days, there will be off days. So it's like seasons, but then you have to look at it for a lifetime. Then, you know, all of these are very small aspects to fit into it, is what my summary about it would be.
Okay, that was a lovely example, and thank you for sharing those personal, you know, connect for entrepreneurs to take care of. Wonderful, Mr. Indraneel Chitle. You know, we truly, truly appreciate the time you've taken out today for the cause of helping small and, you know, medium businesses, especially the micro businesses as well. So all the insights that you've shared, the experience of Chitle Group, in how their growth journey has gone from you know, all the way from 1939 till, you know, the last 81 years of their journey. So we truly appreciate the time you've taken and the insights and experiences you have shared. This is definitely going to benefit a lot of entrepreneurs, and you stand as an inspiration for a whole lot of entrepreneurs, especially the Marathi entrepreneurs, as you rightly put. You know, all of them can take the inspiration and motivation from you as to what one can do, you know, what benchmarks one can reach. So thank you so much for, you know, sparing your time and all that you could share with us today. We truly appreciate it.